Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. On the behalf of the Polish Institute of International Affairs, I'm honored to welcome and introduce to you Daniel Mitov, Bulgarian's foreign minister, who kindly agreed to accept our invitation to pay a visit to the Polish Institute of International Affairs and share with us his views on the challenges at the head of all of us. I mean, the member of the alliance, a month ahead of Warsaw NATO summit, all in Europe and in transatlantic area, are focused very much on our security challenges and how we should respond to them. There are, of course, other issues which are of common concern, if I may say, ahead of us, we have the famous and famous scaring British referendum about the Brexit, which may shape the future of Europe, at least for some time, and definitely is a trouble for all of us. So we are honored and pleasure to have you, sir, here in this institute. And without further delay, I would like to give you a floor, and I believe we would have then a very interesting discussion. Sir, the floor is yours.
Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends. You mentioned without further delay, and I took a look at my watch, and I said to myself, oh God, I need to apologize to everyone. I'm really sorry that it took a lot of time till we got here. The talks in the foreign ministry went a little bit further and longer than we expected, and the press conference and everything else, but I know how irritating sometimes could be the long wait for someone to come and speak, especially when you don't know whether he is going to say something of value or not. Again, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, it is a pleasure indeed to be back in Poland among friends and colleagues. My generation of European politicians will always have a particularly warm attitude and appreciation for the brave tradition of opposition to communism and the long-standing and vibrant culture of defense of freedom. Indeed, part of the political education of people like myself is deeply linked with the bravery of the Polish dissidents and the collective memory and value of their efforts. So, whenever I have the opportunity to come to Warsaw, I am reminded of this passionate commitment to democracy and liberty. More importantly, this is not just a matter of historical recollection, but something that ought to inspire us as we seek to address and resolve a new set of challenges to our values and culture. There is increasingly talk of new normal, a proliferation and intensification of threats, economic disruption, a persistent sense of crisis, and even, as some insist, ungovernmentability. While this might be overdramatic, something is clearly changing in our world, and we need to understand it fully and find convincing responses. The first vibrant and optimistic wave of globalization is receding as its side effects are becoming clearer and begin to affect the Western societies. Economic dislocations, uncertain growth, greater security risks, political difficulties, these are just some of the more general trends we are increasingly facing. Individuals and societies are growing more anxious as uncertainty seems to be the order of the day. Yet, not all change is due to these factors. State actors are changing their behavior as well. For instance, Russia has decided to challenge the norms of a rule-based international order and is engaged in a 19th century style of international relations. Non-state actors exploiting weak or failing states are also threatening ever more aggressively the Western world. As a consequence, to its south, southeast, and east, Europe is facing transformed peripheries, posing long-term risks and challenges which require bold, systematic and imaginative responses from European politicians. So, how do we respond to this set of issues and challenges? Well, let me first say a few things about the European Union. The Union will remain among the key institutions which ensure the continued prosperity and dynamism of our continent. I think there's no doubt about that. It ought to persist as a central pillar of our collective desire to provide growth and security for our citizens in the 21st century. This organization has withstood many crises and emerged always stronger. I have no doubt that this time will be no different. Indeed, given the scale and the magnitude of the present challenges and the need to embed Europe more convincingly in the entire political institutional architecture of the century, deeper integration is inevitable. We have already seen it through the Eurozone crisis, and it is happening now in the context of the migrant and refugee crisis. Integration has to be careful and thoughtful, but also sufficiently decisive in order to deal with the issues at hand. As I have said on many occasions, it cannot be automatic. By presumption, and we increasingly need to take our citizens with us, taking into consideration their views and opinions, explaining to them what we are doing and why, convincing them that this is the best course of action. And here, when I say this, I remind myself something that I mentioned also to the minister here. Very often we were witnessing in the past this situation in which political leaders go to Brussels, they vote, they take decisions, then they go back to their own countries. Their citizens are all of a sudden dissatisfied with what was decided. And when the pressure rises from the public, these same leaders say, well, this is something that Brussels imposed on us. This kind of vicious trend needs to stop. And we need to be sure that we don't delegitimize the European institutions because they're the best thing we have at this moment. They're not the greatest or the perfect thing, but they're the best we have. The migrant and refugee crisis provides ample evidence that only gradual Europeanization of various relevant policies will be able to provide effective and long-lasting solutions. This means a European external border police force, deeper integration in return policy with sufficient funding, reform of refugee policy, perhaps greater powers to institutions such as Europol in order to deal effectively with trafficking networks, and many more. The next EU financial framework must ensure much better funding for these policies and end the temptation to treat them as something of a political afterthought. Yet, as I already mentioned, integration cannot be somehow automatic. There are many issues which require caution. For instance, when it comes to migrants and refugees, we must not allow our responses to undermine the bedrock of our European culture and values. Ethnic and cultural pluralism, let's say the talk about multiculturalism, we should probably discuss this later on, but multiculturalism and what we understand right now as multiculturalism ought not to translate into an alibi for non-engagement and non-integration. Recently, I was trying to think about when we talk about multiculturalism, and we have declared several times already, leaders in Europe have declared multiculturalism as a dead concept because it has created the ghettos in Europe, and we need to be very clear about this. But what do we substitute it with? And I thought maybe we should start speaking about cultural and ethnic pluralism. But what that means, because it contains different things, this notion contains different action. This means that all the ethnic and cultural groups in Europe are participating in the creation and the stability of European civil nations based on clear values, which we all know. Moreover, I do not think for a moment that we could, for example, tolerate practices and attitudes that undermine the rights of women, or simply accept that, despite of our traditions of providing shelter for the persecuted, our continent has an endless capacity to accept refugees. Further, some people persist in treating our nation-states as transient historical artifacts. I cannot accept that view, and it is certainly not a legitimate basis on which to construct our responses in the current crisis. I am also firmly convinced that integration must proceed apace in the field of European economy. This will strengthen our position in a global economy, tilting to the east, but will also provide greater security to those of our citizens who are suffering from displacement and lack of opportunity. Growth continues to be uncertain, and many countries are examining their economic models, making adjustments, introducing new policies. Some further drivers of our collective prosperity need to be supported. These include expanding the single market, which has the potential to lead to higher growth, and developing the digital market, which will enhance many high-value industries. The integration of the capital markets on the continent will ensure easier and cheaper access to capital for millions of small and medium-sized companies. The signing of the TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade Agreement, is particularly important for all of us, not simply because it will bring together the European and the US markets and lead to new opportunities and jobs, but because it will create a powerful Western economic bloc of vital importance in the global economy of the 21st century. One other very important area where EU integration is deepening is energy. Poland was among the countries that initiated the ideas of the EU Energy Union and has been a driving force in supporting of its implementation. Since its inception, Bulgaria has been a firm supporter and active player in making this a reality. There is hardly any need to convince this particular audience of the contribution that a more integrated energy policy will make towards greater security, predictability, lower process, and more opportunity. Progress has not been easy to achieve, but I dare say that we are now well on the way to finalizing and consolidating a set of policies that seemed beyond reach just a few years ago. As an offshoot of this, in Southeast Europe, we are already thinking beyond connectivity, and we are starting to work on the creation of a regional energy market. Ladies and gentlemen, the security environment is changing dramatically, and growing instability and unpredictability appear to be here to stay. Some insist that the new normal appears to be a return to the well-known world of conflict and dissensus. From this perspective, the relative calm and order of the few decades after the end of the Cold War were a mere historical aberration, being currently superseded by the old normal. Again, this might be a bit overdramatic, but there can be little doubt that the post-war rules-based international order is being challenged forcefully, and threats are proliferating. Terrorism is on the rise, facilitated by weak or failed states. Mass-scale movements of people are increasing, as are illegal immigration and various types of trafficking. The familiar list may be prolonged with cybercrime, transnational organized crime, etc. Moreover, we are witnessing the return of the Yalta mindset in Russia, and its annexation of Crimea and intervention in the Ukraine constitute unequivocal evidence for a clear and present challenge to the post-war liberal order. Strengthening NATO is of fundamental importance in this context. The Wales summit will politically was politically a crucial milestone in guiding this response, and the organization has taken a series of very important decisions in order to upgrade the organization in view of the described security challenges. The measures amount to an enhanced response capacity, a repositioning of a variety of assets to improve deterrence, strengthening of the eastern and southeastern flanks, as well as creating a robust overall response infrastructure. In this context, the transatlantic strategic link with the United States remains absolutely vital. Bulgaria will be an active participant in the forthcoming Warsaw Summit, which has to approach the challenges before us with even more ambition and resolve. For instance, we will insist on further strengthening the engagement along NATO's peripheries, the recognition of the strategic importance of the Black Sea, enhancing the open-door policy of the alliance, seeking a good balance between enhanced forward presence and effective reinforcement, and further developing the strategic partnership between NATO and the European Union. The years since Wales have been important in a different sense as well. Politicians and citizens alike are increasingly convinced that the growing range of risks and threats can only be countered by a robust and well-funded NATO. I therefore think that it is no coincidence that the number of member states approaching the 2% of GDP defense spending is constantly increasing. I am happy to say that Bulgaria is also making important steps in the field of security. Just a few days ago, the Bulgarian Parliament approved a 1.3 billion euro multi-year program aimed at modernizing our military and security systems. Looking further ahead, there are at least two other responses that need to be developed. The last few years have finally brought to an end the centuries-old dichotomy of hard and soft security, even if institutional and conceptual inertia are still with us. It is therefore no coincidence that the cooperation between EU and NATO is expanding in a variety of fields, from information sharing to ongoing joint activities in the Aegean Sea. But we need a much more ambitious effort to analyze and institutionalize the synergies and added value that enhanced cooperation brings. Further, the EU has a number of soft security policies, such as combating terrorism threats, law enforcement cooperation, information sharing, countering transnational crime and trafficking, and border management and control. There are also other policies with security implications, such as immigration, even refugees. The EU has to take a fresh look at how to develop and integrate these policies in ways that support the wider security efforts. Some important steps were taken after the wave of terrorist attacks in the areas of information sharing, database integration, anti-terrorism, but we need to look ahead and begin some difficult debates about reviewing and possibly expanding the prerogatives of various institutions such as Europol, Eurojust, the European Prosecutor's Office, and so on. Much can be done to address security concerns at the regional level. This is why Bulgaria has been very active in reinvigorating the process for cooperation in Southeast Europe, established in Sofia exactly 20 years ago in 1996. This process was very often and sidelined, but it has been reinforced to assist the countries in the region in addressing the new challenges. The level of cooperation between EU member states in Southeast Europe has also been increasing in intensity and structure. This has brought particular benefits during the course of the last year's migrant and refugee upsurge. As I already indicated, Russia will continue to be a particular challenge for the years ahead. It is seeking to directly undermine our geopolitical choices using a variety of tools as means of intervention. The Russian leadership has made it abundantly clear that it has numerous misgivings about the current international order. In this sense, we are dealing with a revisionist power which has already engaged in intervention and territorial aggression in full disrespect of the will of sovereign European nations. Dear friends, let me conclude by saying a few words on leadership. In these difficult times, we need to do a number of things. As politicians, we must appreciate the enormity of the tasks facing us and engage fully to define the right responses. But this is not sufficient. We need to take the lead, present our ideas to our citizens, and make every effort to convince them that we are offering good policies with workable solutions. We're not going to succeed if we do not have our people's support. In these times of uncertainty and risks, we must appreciate their fears and concerns, but also convince them that the way forward lies in cooperation, integration, and the preservation of our freedoms. It is through this test of leadership that we will be judged, and we cannot afford to fail. Thank you very much.
And fascinating speech. It gives us a chance to develop some thoughts and ideas and ask you some questions regarding some particularities. You mentioned at the beginning of your speech the trouble we have with European integration right now and the challenges we are facing. And there are many layers of this trouble. One is, of course, that we are dealing with a strong, powerful anti-establishment sentiment around the world, but including Europe. Brexit debate shows us you know, how powerful these sentiments are in the United Kingdom. My question is how we should deal with these sentiments, this mood of, among the public. In the end of your speech, you mentioned the leadership, that we have to bring good news to the people that the European Union is still alive and has a bright future. So the political question is how to do it. Bear in mind that so many people are showing dissatisfaction or losing illusions or share the view that European institutions do not deliver. How we should talk to our people?
I hope it works. You know, when it comes to Brexit, I have a lot of question why do we have a referendum at all. But when it comes to where we are, a lot of people say, well, this is a popular vote for exiting or getting out of the European Union. I'm actually looking at it exactly in the opposite way. I firmly believe that this will be a vote which will seal the place of the United Kingdom in the European Union for years ahead. From what I see, from what I hear, and having in mind that the British people are wise people, actually they can very well make calculations and know what are the benefits and what would be the damages of getting out of the European Union. And I think sometimes the concern outside of the United Kingdom is much higher than in the United Kingdom itself about exiting or getting out of the European Union. I think we are much more worried than the British people themselves. Well, the future will show, the near future will show whether I'm right or not. But I think if the outcome is positive
in the sense that the outcome of the referendum is positive in the sense that the United Kingdom stays as part of the European Union, that will actually have the effect, a very positive adrenaline effect to the EU as a whole. That means a lot. Because I know who will be happy if the United Kingdom goes out. It will not be anyone inside the European Union. It will not be anyone besides the small group of people in the UK, probably political party, political leaders, Eurosceptics. It will be Kremlin. In Kremlin, there will be huge celebration for that. I'm aware of that, and I think every single one of you is aware of that. However, though, how to talk to our people? I think the last bit of what I was trying to say during the intervention was kind of going towards that. Leadership is actually the idea of going against the trend, against the popular trend. Because it's very easy to convince people that things are not going well when there are challenges. Well, you see migration waves, you see economic crisis, you see terrorist attacks, you see aggression in Ukraine, you see all those things, and all of a sudden, it becomes very easy to be caught into the trap of thinking, well, the things are not going well, the European Union will fall apart, or something like that. That's the easy path. And certain politicians are actually keen on grabbing the wave and just going with this mood. The difficult thing, as you mentioned, is how to actually talk the other to defend the other position. European Union has gone through other difficult times, some of them probably even more difficult. I haven't been involved in those issues in the past, so I'm not really the one to talk about it, but probably there were even more challenging and difficult times through which the European Union has gone and has emerged even more integrated. Well, our task right now and our big mission is to do exactly the same thing, to find those policy lines where we can reach more synergy and more integration capacity. And I've outlined them here, especially around the migration crisis. We do have a lot of opportunities when it comes to Frontex and the idea that the European Union needs to look at itself as one whole, and the external borders need to be of common concern and common defense and management. That needs that leads to further integration. So Frontex on one hand, Europol, Eurojust, the European Prosecutor's Office, and you name it. Then on the other hand, unification of the refugee and asylum policies on one side, and also unification of the readmission and return policies. That is also a possibility for bringing certain type of security policies together. We need to take the challenges and the crises as an opportunity to go into a further stage of our development as a union. That goes for the Ukraine crisis, that goes for the migration crisis, that goes for even the terrorist threat, which we actually, I tried somehow to hint on that when it comes to multiculturalism or substituting it with another type of notion and mindset, which continues to respect and lie on the fundamental European values, but somehow tries to amend the deficiencies of the mindset for multiculturalism until the moment.
Minister, there is a growing demand in Europe for a more democratic way the European institutions should operate. And in Netherlands, we had another referendum, which based on this kind of notion, so that people should have a say about, in this particular regard, European Union external policy. We agreed in the Europe that Ukraine should be assisted, that we should give them a helping hand. We signed accession treaty, and, you know, bringing Ukraine closer to the market, giving them the chance to flourish based on our norms, regulations, and the way how we operate within the EU. And now we had another referendum in Netherlands, which challenged this kind of European approach towards Ukraine. Is it a new kind of leadership we are facing? I'm trying to challenge your point, because the leadership may go also in other direction than we want. How we should manage this kind of the sentiment to stream it into the right direction?
Well, I think that when it comes to leadership, it is easy to go against the European Union. That's the easier bit, I think. So there's no leadership needed in that regard. Anyone can do that. Seriously. Anyone can talk right now against the European Union, the European institutions, against whatever has been built in this moment, or at least this is my perception, because I somehow see it and live it all the time. It is very easy to thrash the European institutions and to say they're not democratic. Brussels is, the European Union is the new Soviet Union. I've heard things like that as well. But that's an easy thing. You don't need leadership skills in order to parrot concepts like that. Actually, the leadership is the ability to articulate the opposite and be convincing in that. That takes quite a lot of effort and quite a lot of convincing skills. I'm not really sure whether I can do it. I'm just making a stand. Probably someone else can do it better than I. But that is the going against the trend and being convincing for the people is actually the proof for leadership attitude and skills. But also, I meant to say in the beginning, it came to my mind right now. You know, when the empires fall. Not that the European Union is an empire, but the principle is still sound. The empires fall when the leadership and their people stop believing in the fundamental principles on which those empires are built. That's the beginning of the end. If the leaders, if those who are elected to lead, do not believe in what is written in the European documents as values, as core principles, well, then we have a problem. But if they do, well, they need to defend it. And if they defend it, they will go exactly against the popular trend of, you know, everything is bad, everything is falling apart. So that's the core idea here. And I don't think that the referendum in the Netherlands was really about Ukraine. I think it was about. I mean, there was a mixture of issues there, and there's a huge, how to put this, huge conundrum of ideas that are in a tight knot, and very often in referendums, when you tell the people, well, vote for this, there are many other issues which come incorporated in this all of a sudden, and it becomes about something else.
So, are you in favor of referendums or against?
I believe in the following. Referendums are a useful tool in certain moments. I'm a conservative person, and I'm trying to be reasonable more than anything else. When we have democratic elections with parties who have their programs, who have their positions and so on, and people go to elections and vote for those parties, well, the principle here, and I don't need to tell it to any one of you, is that I delegate, when I vote, I delegate my right for decision-making to my representative. I continue following that representative, whether he's doing the right thing and whether he continues or she continues to represent me in the right manner, but I have delegated this right. And if I'm working in a very different sphere, if I'm a doctor, for example, I cannot follow all the time what's going on in Ukraine or in the Middle East and here and there. I count on that representative to do that for me. And that's why I've delegated a trust. And putting on referendums things which are very far away from the people and the essence of the problematic is very far away. Whenever you throw a topic out there, there's everyone jumping, including liars and people who are trying to get on the horse at the last moment and win popularity, creating a noise and an extremely not understandable situation and throwing out there disinformation even, when then you have a problem because the referendum turns into a farce. I'm not saying that the Dutch referendum was such a thing. I'm saying that referendums are sometimes a trap rather than a well-designed democratic instrument. So we need to be careful. And this is my very conservative opinion in this case, but I highly believe that we need, when referendums are designed, then they need to be well designed. And the questions need to be carefully placed and need to be very clear. And the debate needs to be debate about that very same issue and not turn into a conversation about the universe and everything that it contains. So that is maybe unpopular opinion again, but there we go.
Minister, you said during your intervention that we have to be careful blaming European institutions for all troubles national governments have. Your government probably is watching quite carefully the very peculiar dialogue between the European Commission and the Polish government. How, from the from your perspective, this dialogue is being conducted by the Commission?
Well, I'm not in a position to comment really in depth exactly this issue. What I can say is the following: we have. I mean, the dialogue between the Commission and the Polish government, I'm absolutely sure, will little by little lead to a understanding of what's happening in Poland and what the Commission wants and so on. We have our dialogue with the Commission as well over the CVM and the reform of our judicial system. We cannot deny the fact that Bulgaria still needs certain type of reform steps in the area of judiciary, where we have undertaken them. We've changed the constitution now. We have already amended the law on judiciary and so on and so forth. So this dialogue is not only between the Polish government and the Commission. It's between all the governments, basically, and the Commission, with different type of intensity. What I'm trying always to remember for myself and what I've been taught all the time is there are certain very, very clear, fundamental, basic principles from which you cannot take your sight away. So you need to always be focused on certain principles which make democracy what it is. If you continue following those principles as goals to reach, whatever kind of instrument you use, and no matter how you shape your institutions, the important thing is that your goal is to reach that. So when it comes to freedom of speech, when it comes to our, for example, judiciary, when it comes to Bulgaria, what do we need from the judicial system? We need it to be independent, we need it to be transparent, we need it to be efficient, and we need it to be fair. So if you have those four principles on the table and you look at them all the time and you adjust the institutions in order to reach that through debates and through all the arguments that you might have, but that is your goal, and you need to be able to defend your positions. You need whenever criticized, you need to be able to say, I've done this and that in order to reach all these things which we commonly agree are what we want, what we need in principle. if you are capable of defending that, you will have no problem with anyone.
My last question, because before I'm open the floor for the questions from the audience, my last question would combine both European Union and NATO. Yesterday I had a pleasure to participate in conference about the future of NATO in Vilnius, and one of the speakers was General Ben Hodges, who said that in this particular time we need an effective deterrence towards Russia, and voices which are raising the issue of lifting sanctions against Russia are counterproductive in that sense, that we need, in his opinion, that we need to continue our common approach towards the aggressor, and we need sanctions to stay for at least for some time. What's your position in this regard about the sanctions? Should we have it? Should we soft it, or should we maintain it?
I don't know what more to say. I mean, the position of General Hodges was very clear, and I agree. So basically, why did we apply sanctions at the first place? What we did was try and find an instrument in order to respond to certain challenge. And it was not a simple challenge. It was an act of aggression, an annexation of the territory of a neighboring country, not to mention the Budapest protocols and everything, and we all know that. And it's much deeper, but it's a challenge towards the basic international, the basic principles on which international order is built. So we needed to find an instrument in order to respond to that. It was impossible for us just to stay and continue with business as usual. So no one wants military confrontation, right? It will be disastrous. So in order not to enter into military confrontation, we chose the only instrument we have in order to respond to this type of act. Now, we tied the sanctions to the full implementation of the Minsk agreements, which according to us, if fully implemented, will bring certain type of clarity and stability, at least in the Donbas region. Very well. But the Minsk agreements, until this moment, are not implemented even a small bit. Actually, quite the opposite. The violence on the contact line is increasing. Well, why would we at all even think that the sanctions could be lifted? Blaming it on the Ukrainian side, as some are trying to do? Well, let's first remember that one of the first conditions in the Minsk agreements is for the Russian side to withdraw heavy weaponry and their proxies from there. That is one of the conditions, and basically that has not been done until this moment. We know that. Everyone knows that. So that is one thing. And second, we spoke about this. I recently came up with this probably ridiculous metaphor. But if you go back in your house now after this meeting, and you find out that your living room is occupied by someone has entered your house, shut the door of the living room and says, well, this is not your space anymore. You cannot enter here. And in sign of protest, because you cannot find this person, in sign of protest, you cut the electricity for the living room. It's not the question why you have cut the electricity. The question is why this person is at all there. And right now, we are not supposed to ask why the Ukrainian government has not yet implemented the anti-corruption things that we want. It takes years to implement those and do certain reforms which we want from the Ukrainian government. It is about to ask the Russian side, what are you still doing there? That's the right question. Actually, I have much more questions to ask. if we continue in that way. Probably we will enter into depth in that when it comes to the more deeper talk with the Russian side. I agree we need to have a dialogue with the Russian side, but this dialogue needs to be very different from what we had until this moment. We are in a very different situation, and some actually tend to think that we can all of a sudden return to what it was before. No, we can't. It's over. For years ahead, we need to remodify our thinking about our relationship. It needs to be peaceful, yes. We need to somehow make it work, but it will be very, very different from what it was before.
Now we open the floor. I open the floor for the questions, and I have 5 people on the list, and probably that's all we can have. Ambassador of Romania.
Thank you very much. Ovidiu Drang, Ambassador of Romania to Poland. Thank you very much, Mr. Minister, for your excellent presentation. And I would have two questions. First, you mentioned in your speech, rightfully, I think, the importance of the Black Sea. And I'm particularly grateful for that because I think the situation, the security situation in and around the Black Sea is at least as complex and complicated as the situation in the Baltic Sea. So it deserves our full attention whenever we have the opportunity to speak about that. Now, could you be more specific regarding Bulgaria's expectations in view of the Warsaw summit? How this importance of the Black Sea should be reflected in the decisions taken by the summit in Warsaw? And my second question is about Southeastern Europe. You mentioned that also. And well, our countries have been closely associated to this process of stabilization of the Balkans. And we have done a lot of things together. I remember quite well when I was having the chairmanship of Southeastern Defense Ministerial Process and Seabrig. I was traveling a lot to Plovdiv, by the way, then. And
oh, lucky you.
And how do you see the situation? How do you assess the situation in the Balkans and the perspectives of European and Euro-Atlantic integrations of those countries who have legitimate aspirations in this regard? And what can we do precisely as members of the Union and of NATO to help them speed up this process of getting closer as possible, as close as possible to the European Union and NATO? Thank you.
Next question will take also.
Well, I'm Japanese ambassador. I'd like to endorse the question of the previous speaker, and on top of that, would you enlighten us with regard to the actual Russian military build-up in Crimea and their activities in the Black Sea? And there's not much information around. Thank you.
Okay. Black Sea importance and the NATO summit expectations. Ambassador, you're asking the right questions. You know you are. And I'm pretty sure you know as well that with Romania, we have very close cooperation and common understanding of where we are, what the threats are, what the challenges towards are, and what we need to do in the future. So the Black Sea region is exactly that hinterland where the two major conflicts of today are somehow merging, Ukraine and the Middle Eastern conundrum and disruption. So we know very well that the NATO summit needs to give us a recognition of the challenges we are facing and the idea that the forward presence and the enhanced presence of NATO needs to be implemented and increased. How to do that, the technical details of it, we can discuss them, I think, at length, but probably everyone here will leave before we start even. However, though, in the Black Sea, we need more presence under NATO, under the NATO flag. We need more cooperation with our allies on that. on the maritime side, but also on the land side. You know, we have conversation in that regard as well. Both of you on your territory, you have the you have this what do we call it now? Because the Russian side is very agitated about it, the shield, the anti-missile, exactly. So that is one thing. On our side, we do have our bases, military bases, and so on. So this is a good ground for cooperation, and it is a good fundament in order to move forward towards a better and better presence. We just spoke with Minister Vashikovsky also about common air policing. As I mentioned, the Bulgarian Parliament has voted the resources for the modernization of the Bulgarian army. We will need new air jets, we will need new capabilities for the Bulgarian army. And as soon as possible, we need to honor our commitment to reach 2% of the GDP spent for defense. In the last decades, we lived in a very comfortable time. I'm somehow taking this stand very recently. We unfortunately are returning to challenging moments. And I was saying this in previous interventions as well, a thought from Robert Kagan. Bob Kagan is saying, well, we, the Western world, at a certain point start living unchallenged, and we stop making history. And when you stop making history, someone else will start making it for you. Well, that's what's happening to us right now. And we need to respond. We need to build up our capacities in order to be capable of defending ourselves first, but also trying afterwards to shape the environment around us, not to be shaped by circumstances. When it comes to the Western Balkans and their EU integration and NATO integration of some of them, we are exactly the countries with Romania and with others, of course, with our neighbors, to very much support this European path. European Union will never be complete without the countries from the Western Balkans in the European Union one day. Our first task is to make sure that the enthusiasm, the integration enthusiasm in those countries is not diminished. So this is our first and most and foremost priority. We tried to do that in number of occasions, especially when we were chairing, we just ended our chairmanship in office of the Southeast European Cooperation Process. We tried exactly to do that, and we put the emphasis on connectivity, both transport and energy, which is extremely important for the region, on facing and responding to the migration crisis and on freedom of media. But the first two priorities were somehow, they've been always, one of them is an immediate challenge, but the other one, the connectivity issue, has been always the one of the first and most important vital factors for the development of the region and for moving forward towards more and more integration and more economic cooperation, more people-to-people contact and so on. So we need to use instruments like this, like SECP and other formats in order to drive forward this integration agenda and not let our friends and neighbors to be discouraged on their way to European integration and to NATO integration. And by the way, Montenegro, well, good sign. That's something which gives everyone else the idea that we have not stopped, the open door policy is alive, whoever makes an effort, that effort will be appreciated. And I think we need to continue along that path, and we partner very well with Romania when it comes to the integration of the Western Balkans, not only, of course, but that is that was the focus of the question. The actual military buildup in Crimea I'm afraid, Ambassador, that whatever I know on the question, probably I cannot share very much publicly. But there is an actual military buildup. There is this concern of ours that it might even take dimensions which have not been seen since the Cold War, which is of particular and deep concern. We hope that this is not going to be the case, but what we've seen from the Russian side until this moment is that they don't waste an opportunity to be threatening, including towards Poland and Romania recently. Well, we need to calibrate our relationship in the future, but in the meantime, we are responding to actual threats. NATO is not going to attack anyone. NATO is not going to attack Russia. NATO is not doing anything which is aggressive towards anyone. But we need to respond. There cannot be what is happening in our eastern borders cannot go without a response. Let's put it this way.
Thank you, Anita Shobiak, Polish Institute of International Affairs. Mr. Prime Minister, I wanted to ask you about the cooperation and verification mechanism, which is the monitoring process of the European Commission towards Romania and Bulgaria. When it comes to Romania, opinions are rather split. Some say that it is a very effective monitoring mechanism, which ensures that there is no backtracking of the reform successes that have been achieved so far. On the other hand, there are opinions which claim that this is a clear sign of a negative discrimination of the European Commission against Romania. So I am wondering, what is your position on this mechanism in Bulgaria? Should it be continued? Should it be ceased? Or perhaps it should be introduced also for some other member states? Thank you.
We'll take two more questions. Last one.
Thank you. Piotr Buras, European Council on Foreign Relations. Just a very short question on the refugee crisis, because you, I would like to press you a little bit more. You have talked about some aspects of it. I wanted to ask you how much this refugee crisis affects your country, and what is, in your opinion, the appropriate European response? What should be the main pillars of it, including the most contentious issues of resettlement, relocation, and financial burden sharing? Thank you.
And last one question, gentlemen, here, the second row.
Krzysztof Kogoszczyński, Reactive Polish Office. Minister Mitov, I was wondering, what's your take on the EU-Turkey refugee deal, both in light of the visa liberalization and in terms of the rather strained Bulgarian-Turkish relations? Thank you.
Now is the question.
Yeah. Should have asked those in the beginning. Very well. So first, CVM, Romania and Bulgaria, effective, not effective, and so on. You know, the monitoring mechanism like that is never something good for the image of a country. Basically, if you ask me whether it should stay or it should be gone, I would tell you it should be gone. But in the meantime, I cannot deny that we as a country need to perform certain type of reforms in the judicial system, not only, of course, but in the judicial system, in order to make it work better and reach as close as possible to the standards I described earlier. Efficient, independent, fair, and transparent. So those are the goals. And we're not doing these reforms because of the European Commission or because of the CVN process. We're doing it because the Bulgarian citizens want it. And because it is a good thing. Because we need to reach a to reach the point where we can say, well, our judicial system is transparent, efficient, da-da-da-da-da. So that's the philosophical mindset. So with or without a CVM, that's exactly what we should have been doing anyway. We amended the constitution. We have changed the judicial law. Now we are moving towards other changes and amendments. The effects of it are a different story. They will be seen in the future. In order to measure the effects of a reform, it needs a little bit of time. And I hope with the measurement will come the end of the CVM. It will not be a very good or let's say a sign of good taste for me to comment Romania. I mean, our neighbors and friends, they have their own ways, they have their own reform, they have their let's say path towards removing CVM from their agenda. I can speak about Bulgaria, and I think I made it clear. Yes, we need to get rid of this, but in the meantime, we do need the reform that we are performing right now, and we will see the effects. We are on the verge also of adopting an anti-corruption law, which is very, I mean, it's a special anti-corruption law, not the measures that were incorporated in different laws until this moment. And we hope that that anti-corruption law will lead to the desired effects as well. Democracies are dynamic structures. We can improve them all the time. They never stop actually changing. A democracy never stops changing. People and communities want more and more improvement of their lives, more adjustments, and that's what we need to do. I mean, every politician and democracy is challenged to all the time change, reform, and do whatever it's needed in order to reach a maximum of what the people desire. Now, refugee crisis. There's a lot to be said about this. I will start with this. First, causes of the refugee crisis and the migration crisis. There are two kinds of causes. One of them is, of course, the failed states or the conflicts in countries like Syria, Yemen, Libya, and so on, and Afghanistan. But this is not the only reason. The other major reason for immigration waves is the failure of a lot of states to provide institutional environment which provides the necessary conditions in order for their citizens to develop in their own countries. In other words, countries which fail to basically implement good governmental practices and don't create the conditions for development of their own citizens for different reasons. Well, that's actually the bigger cause for immigration waves. So we have two categories of people. One of them are refugees, people in need of international protection and asylum, towards whom we have obligations according to all the standards. But here I need to make a different statement which goes further on. The refugee status and our obligation towards people who are in need of protection is until the moment in which the conditions which have created this status for refugees are over. So in other words, whenever Syria is politically stable and people can return there and rebuild their own country, well, the refugee status is over. And that is provided in the international framework that we have right now even. Not to say that in the future that needs to be even better adjusted. And the European Union needs to adjust its system towards that. So that's on refugee issue. On the economic migration. Well, there are rules about that. I mean, this indiscriminate inflow of people through borders in Europe is absolutely intolerable for many reasons, but mainly because it makes all the European citizens wonder what are we doing? What all those people we have elected who go to Brussels, to Washington, to here and there, what are they doing? They cannot protect their borders. We still have a certain type of, framework, international framework, which is respecting borders. Well, this type of inflow of people makes us look weak, unprepared, incapable. Now, this needed to stop. As I mentioned already, probably, the European Union needs to look at itself as one whole, with external borders. We need to realize that we are one space. We cannot lose an inch of already gained freedoms and liberties. And we need to defend those. And at the same time, we need external borders, which we need to defend and manage together, so that the internal part is and remains with the freedoms that have been already gained. That is exactly the essence of the first step that you mentioned. What are the steps and what are the essence, the pillars? Well, that's the first step. Reinforce Frontex. Reinforce and create common border police. Put the resources of all the countries in the external borders in order for us to be capable to defend. Let's put it this way. The Netherlands has a border with Turkey. That's the concept. The Netherlands has a border with Turkey, and it is the Bulgarian and the Greek-Turkish borders. That's the concept. And we all need to perceive it like that, like this. Bulgaria has a border with with Libya across the, Italy is probably our border with Libya across the Mediterranean. That's the whole thinking that we need to apply and be sure that we gather our resources and implement them there. That's why I'm talking about more integration, because that's what creates this type of further synergy in the common effort. Second step, fight against human trafficking. Human traffickers are actually one of the biggest problems which we have right now. Criminal groups which are organized from the country of origin to the country of destination, they have their networks in the European Union. Those networks need to be ruthlessly destroyed and tackled. And then when it comes to the last two points actually, readmission and return policies on European level, they need to be very well coordinated. We need to be able to return people in their country of origin if they are not in need of international protection and asylum. And the last point, which is probably the most important, we are talking to third countries about development aid and, of course, combined with return policies and so on. But we don't need to talk to them only about development aid when it comes to roads, hospitals, schools, or building their border system and biometric system and control. We need to, one part of this package needs to be the build-up of institutional framework. So introducing good governmental practices in those third countries. That needs to go together with the infrastructure, with the hardcore. Because what happens, and we can say and have many examples in that regard, what happens is that we build schools, we fund building of schools, roads, hospitals, and so on. And at a certain point, what happens is that because of the political environment, there comes a party which starts a civil war and destroys all that. So when we invest, we need to invest in good governmental practices, like transparency, for example. Transparency in government. We are often accused of being spreading some kind of Western civilizational, colonizational practices. There's nothing in transparency. There's nothing colonizational or anything else in transparency in government. It's just a good governance practice. Sorry, and if you take a look at all the UN development goals, they're related exactly to practices like that. So everyone has accepted them, but at a certain point, when we go and say, let's try and implement and share experience in transparency in government, in independence of judicials, in the rule of law, independence of the judicial system, and so on, in this and that, we receive the answer on the other side, well, you are spreading democratic practices, Western democratic practices, and so on. That's not true. We need to respond to that in a very firm manner. We need to stop putting ourselves down when it comes to this. Because this is again a counter-propaganda, and we're not good at responding to it. That is actually my last point. And EU-Turkey visa liberalization, very quickly. The agreement is working. The pressure on our border is decreasing. However, we need to have a plan B. If, in case, the agreement that for some reason stops being relevant. We need to have a plan B. However, though, we're all working for the implementation of the reached agreement. Visa liberalization could be applied only when Turkey implements all the 72 requirements which are valid for each and every country. We support also the idea of a... What is the term for that? The clause into the agreements which allows the countries to secede and to stop the visa. Right. There we go. Which allows the countries to actually stop the implementation of the visa liberalization agreement if they receive too many infringement practices on that. Well, that's it. I hope I wasn't boring for you, at least.
Minister, thank you very much for being with us, and thank you very much for excellent discussion. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking you, Minister.